Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Zion Lutheran Church this evening. We are about to begin our Vespers service, and what a wonderful service it is, and what a wonderful thing it is for you to be tuning in to join us this blessed and beautiful evening. I'm joined this evening by Cantor Beefy, Pastor Dirty, and our confirmation students. We begin our Vespers service with the service of light.
The Spirit and the Church cry out,
"Come, Lord Jesus."
All those who await his appearance pray,
"Come, Lord Jesus."
The whole creation pleads,
"Come, Lord Jesus."
Joyous light of glory,
of all repentant prayer ascend before you, O Lord, and let your loving kindness descend upon us, that with purified minds we may sing your praises with the church honor and the whole heavenly host, and may glorify you forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
We read Psalm 67 responsively. May God be merciful to us and bless us, show us the light of his countenance, and come to us.
Let your ways be known upon earth, your saving health among all nations.
Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you.
Let the nations be glad and sing for joy. For you judge the peoples with equity and guide all the nations upon earth.
Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you.
The earth has brought forth her increase. May God, our own God, give us his blessing.
May God give us his blessing. And may all the ends of the earth stand in awe of him. Let us pray. Father, through your power, the earth has brought forth its noblest fruit, the tree of the cross. Unite all people in its embrace and feed them with its fruit, everlasting life, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
And now we sing our hymn, The King Shall Come When Morning Dawns.
The next day again, John was standing with two of his disciples, and he looked at Jesus as he walked by and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Grace and peace to you all from our God and Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So dear confirmation students, we find ourselves at the final part of the liturgy of the sacrament, or the almost final part of the liturgy of the sacrament, where we are focusing on the Lord's Prayer and the Agnus Dei. And what I really want to focus on this evening is that little song we sing, Agnus Dei. Can you say that with me?
Agnus Dei.
That is Latin for Lamb of God. And you heard that in John's Gospel, where John the Baptist says, "Behold, the Lamb of God." But before we get into that wonderful title for Jesus, I want to test your trivia knowledge. Back in the 1980s, when I was born, but long before you were born, there was a famous commercial for Wendy's. In this commercial, there was an old lady who had a question, a big question. Some of us older ones know what that commercial is. You younger students, have you ever seen this commercial? This woman, she looks at this burger and she says,
"Where's the beef?"
Where's the beef, right? She says, "Where is the beef?" Because here's this person who loves Wendy's and she sees these other burgers from McDonald's or Burger King or whatever. And it was very paltry, very small compared to this Wendy's burger. And so she said, "Where is the beef?" Well, if we rewind, about 4,000 years ago, we hear another very important question spoken not by an older woman, but by a younger man named Isaac. Isaac was the long-promised son of Abraham. Abraham and Sarah waited 20 years for this promised child to come. And you know what God told Abraham to do with his son? In Genesis 22, to test Abraham's faith, God says to Abraham, "Take your son, your only son, the son that you love, and take his life." What a test of faith. Abraham obeyed. He brought Isaac to the mountain, and there at the foot of the mountain, Isaac looks to his father and says to Abraham, "Dad, I see the wood, I see the fire, but where is the lamb?" Not where is the beef, but where is the lamb? And so Isaac, in that moment, knew that something was up, and as rabbinical scholars say, that day Abraham became a very old man. Isaac asks, "Where's the lamb?" And we see the answer to that 2,000 years after that fact. That lamb would be totally fulfilled, the promised lamb would be fulfilled in Jesus, who is the Lamb of God, spoken by John the Baptist. And we sing about that Lamb of God during the Agnus Dei. "Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, grant us peace." And so we sing to this Lamb who has given his life for us that we might be forgiven. Because in the sacrament, as we sing the Lamb of God, you are preparing yourselves for this very holy moment where God will be placed in your hands that you might eat and drink him, to be fed and to be forgiven and to be given the gifts of God. That is to say, you are given Christ himself. He who is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. So where is the Lamb? If someone asks you when you come into church, "Where is the Lamb? Where's the beef?" What do you say? Where do you point? You point to the altar, right? There is the Lamb of God who has given his life for you that you might eat him and drink him and receive all of his gifts and all of his benefits. You see, lambs in the ancient world, just like today, were used for two main purposes. The main purpose we use lamb for today is ancient Israelites would use lambs and other animals for sacrifices. They would use lambs, they would use goats, they would use bulls. And what they would do with these goats and bulls and lambs and rams and other animals is they would do a symbolic action. They would place their hands upon these animals before they were slain, burned, eaten. They would place their hands upon these animals to transfer their guilt, their sin upon them. And so in that very early ritual of ancient Israel, we see something pointing to a greater sacrifice. Because those sacrifices needed to happen again and again and again, year after year after year, because God's people just kept on sinning. And we still have a sin problem. Therefore, that means we need a better sacrifice, a greater sacrifice. And he who is the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, is that sacrifice. Upon him, all the sin of the world was placed upon him. Now, how do you know if you're in the world? How do you know if you're of the world? Martin Luther had a trick. He said to do this, and confirmation students, if you'd like to do this to see if you were in the world, please follow along. Luther said, if you are in the world, you know that you are in the world if you do this. Take your finger and touch your nose. There you know if you are in the world. Pretty simple, right? That means we are all in the world. That means we are all tainted with sin. This means that we all have a problem with sin. That means we all have a problem ultimately with God. And thanks be to God, he has done something about that sin problem by giving his own son, his beloved son, to be that sacrificial lamb who would die, that he would bear all the sin of the world, bear your sin and my sin, that we might be forgiven. And to be forgiven takes death. For those who have no gospel, how does forgiveness happen? Well, it happens with revenge. If someone does something to you, you want to do something back to them, you want to punch them back, you want to hurt them, you want to kill them. And then that's the forgiveness that happens. It's really not forgiveness at all. But for the Christian, we also need death when it comes to forgiveness. Because when we are called to forgive, we are summoned to die in and of ourselves. That means we do not hold someone's sin against them because the Lamb of God has taken that sin away. This means that we do not remember that sin and harp on that sin. When we look at our little brothers or sisters or big brothers and sisters and say, remember when you did this, remember when you did that. Or we look at your parents, or your parents look at you and say, remember when you did this, or remember when you did that. The Christian, we don't focus on that because that sin is forgiven. Taken away. It doesn't belong to you. God says you can't have it back. It's been placed on his son, Jesus, who is the Lamb of God. Therefore, you can have it. And so that's why we sing the Agnus Dei. It's a beautiful little hymn where we sing to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He who is the Lamb of God who has taken away all the sin of the world. And that includes certainly us. And so where's the beef? Where's the lamb? Where do you find this Lamb of God that you might receive him and eat and drink the food and the cup of salvation? Where do you find this? Where's the beef? Where's the lamb? At the altar. And we sing at this altar, we sing in the pews, and what a beautiful hymn it is to sing about God's forgiveness, about his son, his only son, his beloved son, who has become for us the true Passover sacrifice, as St. Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 5. And may the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus, the true Lamb of God. Amen. In many and various ways, God spoke to his people of old by the prophets.
But now in these last days, he has spoken to us by his signs.
Your grace, Lord, my Savior's praise. You looked upon my lowliness and ever.
peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Holy Church, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Have mercy.
For all pastors in Christ, for all servants of the church, and for all the people, let us pray to the Lord.
Have mercy.
For all public servants, for the government, and those who protect us, that they may be upheld and strengthened in every good deed, let us pray to the Lord.
Have mercy.
For those who bring peace, justice, health, and protection to this and every place, let us pray to the Lord.
Have mercy.
For those who bring offerings, those who do good works in this congregation, those who toil, those who sing, and all the people here present who await from the Lord great and abundant mercy, let us pray to the Lord.
Have mercy.
For favorable weather, for an abundance of the fruits of the earth, and for peaceful times, let us pray to the Lord.
Have mercy.
For our deliverance from all affliction, wrath, danger, and need, let us pray to the Lord.
Have mercy.
For the faithful who have gone before us are at rest, let us give thanks to the Lord.
Alleluia.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Rejoicing in the fellowship of all the saints, let us commend ourselves, one another, and our whole life to Christ our Lord.
To you, Lord.
I thank you, my Heavenly Father.
Through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have graciously kept me this day, and I pray that you would forgive me all my sins where I have done wrong, and graciously keep me this night. For into your hands I commend myself, my body and soul in all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the evil foe may have no power over me. Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom, and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Almighty and merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless and preserve you.
Amen.